necklace. Well, first, can you tell us somewhere about yourself, for people who may not be totally familiar with you?
Yes, I can do that in my sleep. Okay, so I love to eat. Sometimes I eat when I'm not supposed to. I love to eat, but I'm also very aware of what I'm putting into my body. Very concerned about organic eating and stuff. I love to act like you do not want to be my mirror. I'm always doing weird stuff to my mirror. And I feel sorry, but I have no choice because I'm either doing theater or to the world, right? So I rather do it to the mirror. And a little bit more about what I believe in. I believe in just really becoming the change that you want to see and impacting people because, you know, we live in a very interesting time. We live in a time where, you know, things are happening. The President of the United States is from Kenya. You have Lupita and you have won the Oscar. And I feel like we are in a very limitless time. I intend to be among those who take that forward, you know? So that's a little bit more about what I believe in and what I do in my spare time.
Okay. And I find it very interesting as you say that, you know, that women directly from the continent are making such such an impact on our society today. Now, I don't think it's that, I don't believe in coincidence. So in picking up your book and reading it 2 months ago, who would have thought, and your book, you know, the basic theme about the book is a young woman, Yefon, who is fighting for the right to be educated. Mm-hmm. And it is timely, and again, not a coincidence to me, that the universe would place your book to come out at such a time as this. So tell me, do you feel that pull, and do you feel that you are being used for such a time as this? Because of what the subject matter of the book, can you talk a little bit more about that?
Yes. It's a very, very unfortunate time that we find ourselves in. I mean, what happened in Nigeria is just should not be happening in 2014. Should not be happening, period. And that's talking about like now. And you're right, because I mean it's very crazy that this book just came out and then what happened in Nigeria is literally what the book talks about. And I do know, like, being very one with the universe, like, it uses us in different ways to, like, you know, reach out to several topics. And I've been doing a lot, you know, creating awareness in whatever way I can in regards to what's going on in Nigeria. And it's something that we all should do, I think. We should all, because these are our sisters, our cousins, our daughters, for those who have daughters, you know. And this could be anybody, which just happened to be here in this time. But what if we were back home? And we went to school and experienced that. And coming from me, and obviously Diana would understand what I'm talking about because I went to boarding school for 7 years. And it was a place where I met the best friends of my life. I cannot imagine going to school and being abducted. It's just a very sad thing. So yeah, it's something that we all have to be very aware about and just think about these girls every day and pray for them, hoping for the best, you know?
Okay, so if we peel back a little, can you tell us about Yefon? Who is Yefon?
Who is Yefon? That's a very interesting question. In order to answer this question, I have to kind of go back to when I was growing up in Cameroon. For those who know me, I've always been the most unique, strange kid that was in school because I saw things that were not necessarily at the time, you know. Like, I wanted to be an actress at a time when we did not necessarily have a film industry or film structure back in Cameroon. And I would say things and people would be like, what are you talking about? What? Like, okay. But I always felt like, you know, I was a special child. And as a result, everything that I did was in that regard. So when I wrote a book, I first wanted to write about somebody who felt that way. And somebody who was trying to do more than the average person, and somebody who people didn't understand, but somehow she found a way. And that was my initial idea. I didn't know what was going to happen to the story. And then I was very, very touched by something I found out with my grandmother, and that was that she was not very educated. And there was something that happened in her life, and I wonder what would she have done if she was educated, if she had money, she not be in the same situation? And the answer always comes up to no. And so I said, okay, my grandmother's name is Yefon. I was like, okay, I'm going to name it after her. And then I began to do research and research and research. And the more I researched, the more I found out about all these women all over the world. I'm talking about in America, you know, the UK, Asia, Africa, everywhere. And I was like, wow, this is a truly global problem. We are not just raising it in Africa as we think. It's all over the world. It is not necessarily only education. Education could mean anything. It could mean your career. I mean, you have women, you know, who are being married off when they're young, and they never get to follow their dreams. You have women who try to follow their dreams, but because they're women, are put back. There's so many things that happen, and I wanted to write this book for people to remember that, you know, it only boils down to you inside and what you want to achieve. Nothing else matters. Woman, man, African, Asian, fish, dog, it does not matter. If you make up your mind, you can do it. Now, that is what this character embodies, and I wanted to make a truly positive, strong female black character on TV. Because being an actress, I worry about the image of the black woman I see on TV. And I hate to just sit and talk about it. I wanted to change it, like to in my own little way, like create a character that any Hollywood actress would want to play. And that was what I thought about when I was creating this character.
Okay, okay. I noticed also in the book that you have her father
yes.
as a very strong, positive character who supports that his daughter is just different. Can you tell me where that character came from?
Yes, her father. Now, when I was a little girl, I grew up with my grandfather. And he was so special to me because he taught me how to read, how to write. And my grandfather told me that he must never stop reading. It does not matter what. Like, I would come back from school and he's like, what did you read today? I was like, the sign. He was like, what did you say? And I'll tell him, he's like, good. Never stop reading. Read everything. Just go and go. And by the time I was 5 years old, I already had 10 books. And he just asked me, you know, can I read this book? What is it talking about? He was so pushful towards that, you know, wanting me to express myself. And when I, you know, my grandfather passed away 2 years ago, and when I told him I was writing a book, he was so excited. So imagine that he didn't even see it happen. After his death, I specifically fine-tuned the character towards him. He was a very charismatic man, and Yefon's father is that way, like very charismatic. He comes to the room, everyone's like, "Who's that man?" And he believed in her when everybody else thought that she was not and do anything in her life. And another reason, one of the things that I had in mind when I was creating the father character is the African-American society that we're faced with, which is very lacking of the male character in the household. And I wanted to address that. I wanted to show a beautiful relationship with father and daughter that the mother did not even have. The mother was jealous of them. They had a beautiful relationship. And I wanted to impact that because when, you know, literature shapes the mind. You know, I used to love literature my whole life. My teacher told me that it's not just about reading Chimamanda or reading Adichie or reading anybody else just because you want to pass the course, right? You must remember that good literature doesn't only educate, but it entertains, it inspires your beliefs, it does all kinds of things, but it shapes the mind of the people who read it. So I was like, okay, well, I'm writing this book, it's predominantly my characters, and I wanted to show extremely powerful characters in each one. And that was what I had in mind with her father. I wanted a positive, strong man who was there with his daughter before he was killed. And who in every way believed in her journey. And that was the message I was trying to pass out to my brothers who I loved dearly. And to every other man out there, including him and everyone else here.
Okay, well, I wasn't going to say he got killed, but since you already have to know that, why? I guess I, in reading it, I thought, okay, well, no one at this time, it's in 1950s,
yeah.
And, you know, it was unheard of for women, little girls, to go to school. So she has her father, a male, someone who will fight for her. To, well, then why kill him?
Why kill him? That's a good question. No, if you're familiar with the stories and arcs, right, how they go, you cannot make everything so predictable. you have to let the reader be like, oh my god, what just happened? Like, do any of you watch like Scandal or any of the shows on TV? Okay, I see a guilty party here. You're like, I do. I'm gonna have my face. But if you watch TV shows, the reason why they're so captivating is because the writers know what you're expecting and know exactly how to shock you. And you're like, no way. Like, does anybody watch Game of Thrones? Does anybody remember when the king died? I know. I was like, how can he die? Why am I still watching? I'm still watching. I can tell you that. So that was the idea behind it. I wanted the story to be extremely unpredictable and extremely real. And extremely, that character that stood for her, and he died, and the stakes got higher. What's she going to do without this man? He was her everything. So that was the reason why that happened. That's why I made that. It was a very hard choice for me because I was like, oh my god. But and my brother, when he read the book, first thing he's like, why did that happen? How can you kill? Like, he was already so attached to the character. But I did it because I wanted to see what Yefon would do when that backbone was left. Because the point of the story, again, remember, is for, I told you this before, about inspiring us to remember that we can become the change that we want to see. And what does that do for us? It's, things can happen. You can lose the one man, the one woman, the one thing that meant anything to you, but are you going to die? Does that mean that it's the end? It just means that you're supposed to continue this thing with or without them. So that was one of the choice.
Okay. And also, you know, even with the relationship that she had with her mom, which is very difficult, her mother could not understand this young woman who just wouldn't walk the straight and narrow, do what she's supposed to do, do, you know, what society dictates that she should do. Why did you make that relationship so contentious? Because it's even like Yefon, I mean, so many people at Gates, in her own circle, she had so much struggle. Why?
Well, before I speak, forgive me. Well, I grew up in Africa, right? And for most of us who actually lived out there, we know that our parents expect us to go a certain path. You are going to become a lawyer. My dear, you'll be a doctor. My dear, you'll be an engineer. No, you under, let me see this one. No, you engineer this one. And you cannot tell them what you want. How can someone already script your life before you're even born? And some people go a step ahead to even tell you who you're going to marry. You know what? You know, they come from a nice family, his father is a this, one is a this, you're going to marry that man. What? Are you kidding me? So I found myself growing up being like very different because most of my friends did what their parents said. Their parents say this, they jumped at it. But I had my own mind. And not because I'm trying to disrespect them anyway, because I love the ground on which they stand. I love my parents. But I don't believe that you can script my life for me. You had your own experience. You chose the man you loved. You chose the woman you loved. You lived, you did what you wanted, and now you're blissful. Now let me have my chance. Now, that does not always sit well with a typical African family. They're gonna try as much as possible to dissuade you to that. And so I wanted to really show, not just me, because I've heard this very, you know, I've heard lots of people telling me, oh, I wanna be an actress, I wanna be whatever it is, but my family's not supporting. And I say to them, at the end of the day, when you go to bed at night, who do you go to sleep with? You. Maybe a pillow with your teddy bear, pajamas, whatever, but yourself, you know? And so that's why, even though there were all these conflicts, I tried to really make it as complex as possible, just to show us that you can still overcome everything that comes in your way, because at the end of the day, it comes back to yourself. That was why I chose those relationships. And second of all, just from a story point of view, I think it was a better choice to make that she was closer to her father because of what I told you before. This question. So that was why I made that choice for character.
Okay. And of course, the book is called Yefon, the Red Necklace. We haven't talked about the red necklace yet.
Yeah.
Can you tell us about the red necklace?
Yes, I can. Goodbye. Thank you guys so much. I'm so grateful that you came. They actually just walked from my side and bought a book. It's amazing.
Okay.
I'm grateful. Okay. So, Yefon, Red Necklace. So, I already explained to you that Yefon is my mother's name. Right. And Yefon in my dialect, I come from Bad, so is anybody person here tonight? Not really, no,
okay.
Well, I come from the Sahndra tribe in the northwest of Cameroon, and the name Yefon is a royal name, which means mother of the king. Now, Yefon, the red necklace, is only because Yefon is the whole trilogy. We're going to have Yefon, the next book, and the next book. Now, the red necklace is because what specifically happens in book one is that when her father dies, he leaves her with that necklace. And it was a gift that he gave her on her 16th birthday. And it was the only thing that she had to hold on to after his death. She was holding on to him because she felt like it was her only connection with him. Only to realize that it was not by happenstance that he gave her that particular necklace. The necklace is actually a talisman from the gods. And whoever wears it is the person who wants to spark change in the community. Whoever wears it is going to become the next legend. And she must find what is her legacy. She only is a legend because she has a necklace. And it says the necklace was specifically made by the gods, right? And the person who had it before her was the ancestress of a tribe. She found the tribe. So she's like, so what am I supposed to do? So I found that red is a very powerful color. You know, it signifies strength and just a lot of power. And that's why I picked red, you know, because I'm very big in energy and what that signifies and so on. And I thought that the red necklace was the perfect way to go with book one. So that was why we have that title, the red necklace. Yeah, for the red necklace.
Okay. All right. So as we look to wrap up now, and you talked about the red necklace, and you talked about the person who has that red necklace
and
is one that inspires change. Do you believe that that your destiny and what you are ultimately supposed to do and who you are supposed to be is chosen for you? Or is that something that comes from within you and then you just have no choice but to be and become that person? Like, because you said the red necklace chose you. Did it choose her?
It chose her.
Okay.
But she was rising the plate. Now, that's a very beautiful question, and I believe so many movies have tapped into that, like if you try to answer it or attempt to bring up the discussion, right? And this is my take on it. My take on it is, I do believe that we're caused to certain things at some times. And the only reason I say that is because of our DNA. It never lies. Now, who your mother was, who your grandmother was, that's why it's important to know your history. Know who you are, what you were once a part of. You carry all that with you because DNA has memory. So because of that, yes, you are called upon only because if your mother was doing X, Y, Z, then a part of you already has that. Now, I also believe that you must rise to the plate. If, let's say your mother was, you know, your father was Martin Luther King, and you're just going to sit here and smoke weed all day. Okay, I want to see how that ends. Now, you have to rise, you have to make a decision and say, you know what, this is what my calling is, or this is what I feel more drawn towards. But I'm going to put in the work to become that person that I believe I already am inside. Because you always know. Your intuition never lies to you. That's why you would see an 8-year-old child saying things like, oh, I'm a rich man, and say anything to him. But he already knows or saying something that kids will not even know the vocabulary to say. Have you ever experienced that? Like a child says something, you're like, who's talking? They're looking everywhere, and it's a little shop, you know, little baby saying stuff that he's not even supposed to know the vocabulary, but he already knows. But I feel like as parents, they must encourage that. And sometimes the African parents do not help, and they instead try to push you away from it, except it's something that seems in that line of doctor or lawyer. And so I really call upon us to be more supportive of our children's dreams. Because one of the big things, we had a party on Twitter, an education party, and we're talking about what is education, really, when you think about it? Does it necessarily mean the system in school, or is it other things as well? And you realize that everybody has their own bliss, and everybody has their own genius. That's why you have Michael B. Jordan, who shows in the circle in the basketball field. He may not, I don't know how his video went, but he may just not be perfect in school, and vice versa. So you must find what your niche is, and just put 100% into it to find your genius. So, I may have to rail a little bit, but that's the answer to my question.
Okay, so my final question to you is,
yes.
Sahndra FonDufe, who were you called to be?
Wait, so so random, because like in the Beyonce video, right? When you say, so what is your ambition in life? And she goes, and I just did it. And so I was like, wait, well that isn't so but who am I called to be? Let's see. Let me try to describe my perfect career to you. My perfect career in simple words would be Oprah's career. In simple words. I think I'm truly called to be an inspiration to people in my generation and as I get older, as that rises. Because there's certain things that I stand for and I believe in. And I believe that more people need to understand why we should believe in those things and why we should carry those things as a people. Now, I have a very specific look. It's by choice. I'm very specific. My agent sometimes I'm trying to, but I'm very specific on it because growing up as a child, I talked a lot. I still do. I'm sure you've already noticed.
No.
No, okay, good. But we do not really have that many role models that look like you. Like, all my dolls were white. All the shows on TV were white. I could see all the Barney sounds, but we only had one cartoon, which was called Kiriko, which is one of the only black cartoons even now from Africa or the African continent. So I really say, why do you, how do you expect your children to have confidence in themselves or to say, you know what, I can do this, I can do that, when they don't even see people like them representing them in different fields on the media or in the world? How do you expect your children to say, I can be this, I can be that? When celebrities get famous, they do all this plastic surgery, look different. What do you expect your children who look like me to think? You know? So I decided that, you know what? I'm going to be that person. I'm going to be the person that when a young black child looks like, she'll be like, oh, I want to be like Sandra. And not that, I mean, that's very difficult to do. It's not easy, but I take the challenge because I want to be there for them. I want to be the older sister, someone that they can ask questions to. Because I will talk, I don't care how rich I get, I will talk to anyone, answer whatever question that I can help with. And if I don't really answer, they will be hearing to whoever it is that may not answer the question. So that's what I think my call is. And I think my call is really just building schools and stuff with the same message, training young girls that will become the next leaders of Africa and of the world tomorrow. So I think that's what it is.
Well, we thank you. Thank you for your phone.
Thank you.
We thank you that you started when you were, what, 22, right?
Yes, I'm
22. And
21 and a half.
And that was the first thing I felt when this book arrived in the mail. I thought, you know, what was I doing at 21, 22? I wasn't doing this. So, God bless you. We commend you on what you're doing. You're making us very proud as a young Cameroonian. Keep doing what you're doing, keep championing, trying to be a change agent, and beating that drum for educating young women and young people and striving to be that example. Thank you. We haven't seen you in any craziness in Hollywood. We know we're all holding her accountable, right?
Wow.
Right? So, best of luck. And we know we're going to see you with book two and book three.
Yes.
Please come back.
Yes, I come back. I'm thank so excited for the next book.
Thank you so much. And thank you so much to DC Public Libraries for hosting us today and to continuing to offer diverse programming. We really appreciate it. Cameroon American Council, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Corey's Closet, thank you. For all of the supporters, thank you so much. And Sandra, it's from that part. You know
that.
Thank you so much, representatives from the embassy coming out. And your school, your, I don't know what you call them.
Lessa.
Lessa. Right, in the house. So thank you so much, everyone. And good night.
Have a wonderful night.